So my name is Alex Nasonov. I'm a member of the NetBSD project. Let me figure out how to turn it on. So I work on the kernel side. Like my biggest project was BPFJIT, and also I added AES XTX disk encryption to NetBSD. I also maintain a dozen of packages and package source. I think several Lua packages and some random packages like Valgrind. Even though it does run on NetBSD, it runs on Linux, and package source is multi-platform package management system. It can run on Linux. So I maintain non-official Miro, which is hosted on Tor. It's called package source by dj4v .onion, where you can download these files. I had to run some special program to guess, to pick a good name for it. So you can download these files, source tarballs from there, or you can install binary packages for NetBSD, for all architectures. Basically Miro, some German Miro of NetBSD, of French, I don't remember, but it's a complete a Miro of packages for NetBSD, but not for. I also became a contractor recently. I live in London and I work on low latency high performance software, do C++, assembly, and LuaJIT. It's probably not, it has nothing to do with package management, but I use package source all the time. Every time I start at a new place, I install a bunch of packages. Package source allows you to install unprivileged builds, so I don't have to have a root. And they eventually grow to 200, 300 packages, just my local packages for my convenience. So I also build mini compilers and domain-specific languages. It's a lot of fun to generate assembly on the fly and execute it. this is my I have two kids, and I ask them to draw a picture how they understand the Tor. And this is my daughter's picture. She thinks, I keep pressing the wrong buttons. She thinks it's you in the middle of the Tor. And you connect to those nodes, blue rectangles or squares, which is internet or ClearNet. And the idea of the Tor is this is you in the middle, the client, and instead of connecting to your to a website, you want to connect to directly, you go through hops, and there are three hops: your guard entry point, middle relay, and your exit. And when you connect or when you send traffic to those nodes, it's encrypted multiple times, and each node decrypts one layer. So that's why it's called the Tor the onion router. Each node peels off one layer of encryption, and each node knows about where the traffic came from, where it's going to. But because there are more than two nodes or three nodes, it does know a final destination. It only knows about two neighbors, and that's it. So this is if you want to connect to ClearNet or internet, you go through three hops in the Tor network. But if you want to connect to hidden service like my package source bad DJ blah 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 dot onion, instead of going to a website, you go to a rendezvous point, and this is where your client meets with the server, with that hidden service. So both parties connect to a rendezvous point through, they go through hops, and then this is where they meet. And this guarantees privacy while maintaining real-time characteristics of the Tor network. So, and the next picture is by my son. He draws some people around the globe or Tor sending messages, and then I mentioned that for sending messages you don't need real-time you can use mixed nets. And you know, then he asked, can I, you know, put mixed nets inside the toy? And I said, yes, you can. And that's why you see this MN mixed nets. But it's a different concept. So yeah. So this one, this slide was, I decided to finish it, you know, at the very last moment. But instead of putting all this, you know, my thoughts together, I spent all this morning troubleshooting some interesting problem because I want to give a live demo, and I couldn't, you know, I couldn't do it in the morning. I said, you know, but hopefully it will work. So it's not very organized, this one. So. Yeah, if you install packages over ClearNet, every time you download, it's observable. So they, you know, whoever is watching you, they know that you connected to netbsd.org, and they know your IP. And if you connect over plain HTTP, they see the content, they know what software you downloaded, what versions, and whether that particular version is vulnerable or not. If you use HTTPS, they see a connection from your endpoint to a website, but they don't know a content of it. But they still see sizes of your downloads. They can guess, you know, what which package you are downloading. And also there are things called middle boxes. Essentially, some companies can buy a certificate, valid certificate, specifically to sell products which intercept HTTPS traffic. It's, you know, because this thing is, you know, HTTPS is centralized, it's possible to, and it's quite common in corporate environments to have middle boxes which listens to your intercepted traffic. And, you know, because you are not going to check, like every time, you know, you're not going to open your, you know, a long list of certificates and, you know, check whether, you know, to which particular certificate you use and whether it's good or not so good. So yeah, that's essentially man in the middle attack. They can not only intercept, well, yeah, interception is a bit different, but they, it's passive, but they can also send a different traffic, you know, ensure some themselves in the middle, and you know, and send a different traffic, like a different version of software. Yeah, size is observable. My friend suggested to host a mirror, like, you know, you, instead of downloading only you know, packages you're interested in, he suggested downloading the whole thing, like 20 gigabytes of packages or whatever, and then install what you need. But if you do rsync, it's also incremental, and they can observe deltas and stuff like that. So it's it would be nice to hide your activity from whoever is watching. So yeah, Tors gives you anonymity. You know, when you connect through three nodes, if they are not, like if they cannot be all observed, like if it's not, like if it's some local enemy or whatever, you know, you're fighting with, then if they don't control the whole network of the world, then it's very hard to track, because you jump through hoops. And also, if you download something from a hidden service cannot be, you know, the name itself is a proof that is a proof of identity. So when you create a hidden service, it creates a private key, and the name of that service is derived from a private key. And if you know the name, it's a proof that that, you know, that whoever is behind on the other end is you know, owns the private key, and you know, you can trust, if you can trust the security of the private key, you can trust your connection, because end to end encrypted multiple times. Yeah, I think that's it. I wanted to put something else here, but yeah, I spent a lot of time troubleshooting. So prior art. So there, on Debian, you can install this app transport.tor package, and also on some derivatives. I'm shortly going to mention Tails, you know, which comes with this software pre-installed and pre-configured to download everything via Tor. So, and on other Debian if they have this package, you can just add. I'm sorry, I don't use Debian. I don't use Linux. I don't know much about it, but I think that's pretty much it. If you want to connect over Tor or manage packages over Tor, then I think that's probably the only option available to you. And one thing to note is that it requires non-standard Tor plus HTTP scheme or protocol in here. It's probably something simple. I've not looked at it, but usually. If you have a non-standard scheme here, then you expect some special handling for it somewhere in your stack. Ideally it should be, HTTP, because you can trust HTTP over Tor, because the names themselves are proof of identities, and this is not centralized; it's decentralized. So what is package source? Package source is cross-platform package management system. It runs on NetBSD, where it came from. It runs on Linux, and I use it because I've used it for about more than a decade, at day job. And macOS, I tried it. It worked, but I don't use Mac, FreeBSD, and OpenBSD, other BSDs, Solaris, and it works on Windows. And historically, I think it worked on, I forgot the name, was Unix Services for Windows or something like that. But these days, you can install Ubuntu, and this is what I did. My presentation is based on this setup on Windows. So this is Windows, which is quite unusual for me, because I bought it only a few months ago to one particular task, and but when I discovered Ubuntu, it became so much fun. I can just keep using it, I guess. What you need to start managing packages over Tor, you need Ubuntu on Windows, or you can use Tails Live CD. I tried both, but I used Windows for the presentation. You use a Tor browser. Basically, you from the Tor browser, you only need a SOX proxy. But because it's on Windows, it's much easier to just launch a Tor browser, which will give you proxy, and then you can do your stuff instead of trying to download the service which provides a proxy. Maybe it exists, but I've not bothered. I just use Tor browser. And a nice side effect: if you use Tor browser, if you close the Tor browser, all your connections will close, and you can check whether you're connected via Tor or not. So you also need to understand basics of package source. You can go to packagesource.org and read the guide. This is what I did long time ago. I just read the whole thing to understand what it's capable of and how to work with it. So you need to prepare your host, because you're not doing it on NetBSD, you're doing it on something else like Linux, Ubuntu, Windows. You need to download some compilers, libraries, but not many, just a couple of libraries. And then you need to clone package source over Tor, then bootstrap to create a minimal working package source system, then build essential packages, and then build other packages. Yeah, and then you can, once you build all packages, you can host your binary packages on a hidden service, and then you can download and update your binary package, download over that hidden service and update your binary packages. This is what I do. I have a server at home which builds packages for my notebook, not this one, because this one is on Windows, my other notebook. And for my Tor relay and my main web server, DNS server, soon mail server, it's all updated over Tor from my server in my house. I don't even need an external IP for that. It's a good idea to update your host environment first. If you do it on Tails, it will already download everything over Tor. On Windows, it will be visible, but it's not the end of the world. So then you can install essential packages like GCC compiler, C++ compiler, and Curses development, because it needs some header files and stuff. CVS It's a concurrent version control system. It's very old. Don't laugh at me. Yeah, there was a talk. Jörg gave a talk earlier today about migrating to something else. But it works. And then you need to install some package, some tool to download your tarball, source tarballs, and you need a tool to connect to a SOX proxy. So this too gives you those two abilities. In order to start using CVS or anything else that connects over SSH, or including SSH itself, you need to add a special proxy command to your SSH config file. Can be global or local. In this case, it's a local file. And it's only for wildcard netbsd.org and for all onion services. And when you want to connect to one of those hosts, it will pipe your commands, your traffic will go through this tool, which will connect to this SOX port. This is what the Tor browser uses by default, and it will connect to your hosting port. It's on Ubuntu. On Tails, you can use Netcat. And actually, I don't think you need to do anything on Tails because they already have this command. It's a bit different, -x SOX proxy version 5 and the rest. You can, now that you set up your SSH, you can clone. And this For those of you who think that CVS is old, so this is really old. When I first started using CVS 2 decades ago, this comment was already archaic because no one used RSH anymore. Everyone used SSH at that time. And then you can export CVS root, and then you can check out package source. It will take a while, and if you want to check whether it's downloaded over Tor, you can just close the Tor browser. It will terminate this program immediately because it's connecting over the Tor. If you have a GitHub account, you can use this. Why do you need to have a GitHub account? Because it will use CVS or SSH. Sorry, this will use SSH. And if you try to download via HTTPS here, then you will need. Not a SOX proxy, we'll need HTTP proxy, which we don't have at the moment, but we will install it later. Next step is bootstrapping package source. After the installation, you will have the main configuration file called mk.conf, and you can actually specify parts of it, important parts of it, before you start building and start the bootstrap process. And you can specify make jobs, run for jobs in parallel. Prefer package source means avoid external host dependencies. Try to build self-contained system. Update target and depends target. It's when you every time you make manually type make package. Package install, it will also create binary packages for all dependencies. And for this one is when you do bmake update manually, it will also create binary packages for everything, which is handy because you want binary packages to later update on a different host, for example. So package source not required, but it's handy for some tools. And this is important. You say fetch using this tool and use SOX proxy on your local host listening on this port. And every time you download, it will connect through the SOX proxy. I put this one because you cannot. So ideally, you should use. Curl from package source, but what happens if you there is a chicken and egg problem when you try to update this package itself. And I tried it because there was an update recently of the curl package, and it failed. But you can always if you have a host tool installed, which you have, because you installed it previously, then it should work. And master site override means every time you need to download a source tarball, you first go to a master site. Usually it's like GNU.org or, you know, whatever, or GitHub. This is the main distribution of a particular package. But if you specify this, first it will try to use my Onion service to download over Tor. And then if it's not available, then it will try other alternatives. So this is for very advanced users. If you are prepared to deal with problems, it's like hardening your system. It works. It works on NetBSD. I think it builds on my Windows machine, but not everything. And I switched. I just don't do it. I'm not ready to deal with the problems. Bootstrapping is easy. You just go to this is where you downloaded your package source directory. You go to the Bootstrap subdirectory, and then you do bootstrap. Unprivileged means you don't. Everything will be installed under your username. You don't need root in this prefix in this directory and with this fragment. This is the file I showed you earlier, and this one is. On some Linuxes, shell is not POSIX enough, I believe. You need to specify bash, which works with this script. Build essential packages. Package tools digest. I don't normally build it because it's available, but I think when you specify preferred package source, this is like MD5 checksums. Yeah, it's probably because it's not available on Ubuntu in my setup. So you need MD5 checksums because every time you download something, it checks the integrity of downloaded file using checksums. And then to build it, you just do bmake package install. It's a good idea to add this path to your path. Package bin and package s bin, but it works without adding it to the path. This as well. Hopefully it will be new and better version. This is HTTP proxy, which can connect to your SOX proxy, which is in your Tor browser. And this is required for some tools or for all tools which download binary packages or install binary packages. Simple web server for hosting your packages. It just package check allows you to build a list. So you specify a long list of packages you want to install. Then you can do, you can say with a single command, you say install everything from source. It will build everything. Or you can also say install everything from binary packages on different box, and you point to your directory where your packages are hosted, and it will download them and build them. Pbulk, it's for I used it for a while, but I will probably come back to it, but I switch back to package check. So if you want to build all packages or a lot of packages, then you can use it, and it's better than package check, but it's more difficult to set up. Package in, it's very simple tool which also can be used to do package management over Tor. It's like apt, you can do install, remove, update, full upgrade. A clean, I think it's very similar. This is just for fun, if you want to see dependencies of all your installed packages and you want to visualize them. And by the way, I built all those packages, and I also built LaTeX packages because I decided to use LaTeX and build everything on this machine in using packages built with package source. So it's all this setup is quite advanced, and it can generate PDF from LaTeX Beamer packages. So demo time. Okay. So do you see? Okay. So I have this Ubuntu, and every time I close it, I think it's like init process. It kills the init process, and it kills everything. Can you see it? Okay, and I think it's clean setup. Let me check if I still have. Okay. So first, right. Let me go through the steps first. Sorry, I'm probably creating a noise. My mic has dropped. Right now. Okay. So, yeah, first we configure and start a new hidden service. Then we start a web server to host binary packages. And then we remove some packages.